but alhamdulillah, inshallah, we can share some beneficial words about the life of Sheikh Muhammad Ayyoub, Rahimahullah ta'ala. I started listening to the Sheikh, I think, a long time ago, just when I first started practicing. And my own connection with the Sheikh is quite emotional. It's because it was at a time in my life when I was going through a lot of change. And so his voice, and not really knowing much about Arabic at the time, and just hearing the emotion in his voice, really made me wonder, subhanAllah, why is he reciting it in that way? Why did he recite that verse in that way? Why did, in this part of the verse, he recited like that, and then his voice went sad? And it was like, I found that, subhanAllah, he was a master of qira'ah, and he was a master of emotion in the way that he reflected what he was reciting perfectly. So that, it was, you know, alhamdulillah, that was like an emotional connection in my life. And I think the life of the Sheikh, there are so many examples we can take from him. Right from his earliest upbringing, he was born in Makkah in Saudi Arabia, and from a very young age, he was immersed in learning the Quran. He wasn't Arab, as many of you know, he was Burmese, and his family fled the oppression in Burma from a long time ago. So he was quite young when they moved to Mecca, and during his early years, his father, Rahimahullah, he was involved in trying to get as many refugees from Burma out of Burma and into Saudi Arabia. And he sort of got caught up with the government at the time, and his methods weren't entirely legal, and he spent some time in prison. And so during that early part of the Sheikh's life, his father was in prison, and while his father was in prison, he himself was the eldest of his siblings, so he had to do two things. He had to A, support his family and support his siblings, and also B, he would go and memorize Quran at his masjid. And the Sheikh mentions in an interview that between his home and between the masjid in which he memorized the Quran every single day, there were two mountains, like two hills. And you have to remember, this is 1960s Makkah in the 1960s, so you had you had roads, but not that many, and nothing like it is today. And you don't have any of the tunnels that were bored through the mountains that you have now, which make it so easy to go from the outskirts of Makkah right through to the Haram. It's so effortless now. Back then, you didn't have any of that. You had to climb mountains. And the Sheikh mentions in an interview that between his house and his masjid, there were two mountains, and you had to go up and come down and go up and come down each one. And in between them, there was no electricity at the time, and there were like wild dogs and all sorts of like wild animals. You know, if anyone's been out there and spent extensive time out there, you'll notice wild dogs and scorpions and snakes and all that is pretty normal out in the desert out there. So the Sheikh had to deal with that every single day, and he had to get to his class before Fajr every morning. Otherwise, his Sheikh he was quite a strong personality. The Sheikh's father was released a couple of years later, and alhamdulillah, he completed his hifz and he went on and he moved to Medina later on in his life. And in skipping a couple of years, alhamdulillah, he spent a long time with his teacher, Sheikh Khalilur Rahman. Sheikh Khalilur Rahman is originally Kashmiri, of Kashmiri descent. His sons now are lead in Taraweeh in Masjid Quba and Masjid Qiblatain. And mashallah, like, I don't want to get nationalistic or anything, but the Pakistanis are killing it when it comes to the shuyukh of qira'ah in Medina, mashallah. So he studied with him for a long time, and whenever you hear about Sheikh Muhammad Ayyoub talking about his teacher, and his teacher is still alive, he's very distraught over his son's death at the moment, but alhamdulillah, he spent a long time with him, and he would go with him, travel with him city to city, and he would recite to him every single day. And it was through his love of the Qur'an and his dedication to its memorization, through his daily muraja'ah with his shaykh, that he really excelled in it. And his teacher held him to a very, very high and rigorous standard simply because he saw great potential in him. And so he was very strict with him. I remember the shaykh mentioned, and the same thing happened with his son, that the way that they used to learn was that they would go to the shaykh and he would make his students pray nawafil, and they would recite up to four juz in one sitting, and the Sheikh would be behind them with a stick whenever they made a mistake. And sometimes if they made a mistake, he'd make them start from the beginning of the surah all over again. So this kind of method was unheard of, and it was very, very strict. And alhamdulillah, that led to the reason why, mashallah, the Sheikh's hifz was very, very strong. Um, and you saw that later on in his life when he lived in the Haram. As he graduated, alhamdulillah, he I think in 1410 Hijri, which is I think 1990, the Sheikh, he had just been newly appointed to Masjid Quba. And at the time, the head of the Imams of Masjid Nabawi and the Khatibs, Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Saleh, he heard, someone came to him and said, look, there's this new Imam in Masjid Quba, his name's Muhammad Ayyoub, he's really good, you should hear him, you should check him out and see what you think. So I said, okay, yalla, call him. He told his son to call him. So when Sheikh Muhammad Ayyoub heard about this, he got really scared because, I don't know if, this was in the late 80s, and the Sheikh was a very, very strong personality. You know, he's the kind of guy who's like, you know, if you've got a really strict father, you just hear his name, or you hear him coming, you get shook. So the Sheikh was like, okay, I might have done something wrong. So he was really scared. So he went to the gathering where the Sheikh had invited him, and he sat right at the back where the Sheikh sort of couldn't see him, like around the corner. And then right towards the end of the gathering, the Sheikh Abdul Aziz was like, where's Muhammad Ayyoub? Tell him to come here. So he told him, he came and he sat him down next to him and he said to him, Iqra, he said, recite. So the Sheikh was like, all right, this is all right. Okay. And by that time, obviously, the Sheikh was an accomplished, he was in his early 40s, and by then the Sheikh was a very accomplished Qari of the Quran. So, wallahi, for people like that, reciting the Quran is like drinking water and it's like breathing air. It's a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he did what he did best. And alhamdulillah, the audience was wowed and the Sheikh was like, he was taken aback. So he just whispered in his ear, he said, and this was at the end of Sha'ban. There was literally, I think, 1 or 2 days from the start of Ramadan. And he said, first night of Ramadan, you're leading a Masjid Nabawi. So you can sort of imagine, like, he's a hafiz of the Quran, his hifz is strong, but even then being told that news, yeah, you got one day, you're leading in the Prophet's Masjid. So you can imagine the Sheikh was like, I went dizzy. He said, I couldn't believe what was happening. It was just an astounding moment for me. So he said he arrived on the first night in 1410, the first night of Ramadan, and he stood in the minbar, and he was very scared. He said my heart was pounding, my hands were shaking uncontrollably, and I couldn't believe that, you know, I have this responsibility of standing in the mihrab of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because you have to remember that if anyone who leads salah regularly, anyone who's the imam of a masjid, you know, hifz of the Quran and your strength in memorization is one thing, but standing in front of people and reciting it is a completely different science altogether. And the two of them are totally different. Like a person, that's why you notice someone who's a strong hafiz of the Quran, can, when he stands in front of people, if he's not used to leading, he will make mistakes in small surahs. And so because of this, the Sheikh was very scared and he said, Ista'antu billah, and then he started, he sought help from Allah and he started. And alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped him. And his first year in Masjid Nabawi, in the first Ramadan, he was one of the few imams, I think only two in recent Hijri history, who for the entire month of Ramadan, apart from 3 nights, he led all 20 rak'ahs of Taraweeh and Witr by himself. And there were a couple of friends that he managed to get to come share with him on some of the nights, but each one of them after just one night pulled out and said, it's too much for me. So all 30 nights apart from three, so 27, he led 20 rak'ahs by himself on his own, and including the Salat al-Witr. And that entire recording, the 1410 Muhammad Ayyub recording, is found widely on the internet, and it's not an exaggeration, subhanAllah, to say that it's a masterpiece of Qiraat. Anyone goes there and you listen to that masterpiece, subhanAllah. So alhamdulillah, I think, you know, it was a great blessing, alhamdulillah, to meet the Sheikh many times. And every time you meet the Sheikh and you sit with him, he was a very stern figure. In fact, the very first time I met him and I sat in front of him, he said to me in Arabic, "Mada tatalub minni?" What do you want from me? So when that moment came, everything went out of my head. But alhamdulillah, I was close friends with the Sheikh's family, and so they sort of took me to see him. And every time I met him, he was a man of just very humble, very quiet, and you see his akhlaq were just amazing. And he was a kind of person that anyone who knew him and spent time with him knew that he really didn't have a care of the matters of the dunya. His morning till evening was involved in the Quran. He would teach in the Jami'ah, in the Medina University, he would teach tafsir. And there's many, like subhanAllah, since his passing, many of his students who studied tafsir with him came out and told their stories and their experience with the Sheikh. And they would say he was just a man who was just very humble. He would not excessively socialize with people. But if he opened up to you, he was very warm and very friendly. And he traveled over the world. He went to Brazil, he went to Turkey, he went to Pakistan, he went to India, he went to Burma, he went to Malaysia, he went to all sorts of countries. He did dawrat, he did knowledge retreats, teaching fiqh, aqidah, teaching Quran, etc. So he was very active right until his last days. And when the Sheikh, he retired, I think in 2014 from the Medina University, he had a regular hanaqah in Masjid Nabawi where accomplished hufadh, strong hufadh, who are all pre-tested, would come and sit and recite to him and trying to gain ijazah. And the Sheikh would insist that you had to finish the Quran three times to him before he would even think about giving you an ijazah. And I sat in a circle sometimes, only subhanAllah, Allah blessed me to go meet the Sheikh 10 days before he passed away. And this was on an Umrah trip that I had not planned at all. Someone basically called me up and said, we want you to come on our group as a tour guide. And I refused for a long time. And then something towards the end said, we might as well go ahead. So alhamdulillah, Allah took me there, and it was 10 days before he passed away. And we met with the Sheikh and sat with him, and I was just astounded. He used to sit there and just close his eyes, and he'd have four students recite to him at the same time. And each person, he would stop and correct, stop and correct, stop and correct, stop and correct. Like nothing would pass him. And that was in a noisy environment of the Haram. It was sort of near the back where the umbrellas are. So he would, subhanAllah, he wouldn't. And that was in his advanced age as well. So alhamdulillah, it was, you know, it was always a pleasure to sit with the Sheikh and meet with him and benefit with him. And in my first meeting, I actually recorded a short nasiha from the Sheikh about memorization of the Quran and what advice he would give to students from the West.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. حفظ القرآن الكريم من الأمور المهمة التي ينبغي أن يعتني بها الأمة المسلمة في أي مكان كان، سواء كان في بلاد الحرمين أو في أي بلد من بلدان العالم الإسلامي. وحفظ القرآن مستنده الأساسي هو أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يحفظ القرآن، وكان معه صحابة كثيرون يهتمون بحفظ القرآن الكريم، وكان يقتدى بهم، ومنهم أبي بن كعب رضي الله عنه، وعبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه، وغيرهم من حفظة القرآن. وكان صلى الله عليه وسلم يحب أن يسمع القرآن من غيره، وكان يستمع لعبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه، وبدأ يقرأ عليه من أول سورة النساء إلى أن وصل إلى قول الله سبحانه وتعالى:
فكيف إذا جئنا من كل أمة بشهيد وجئنا بك على هؤلاء شهيدا؟
قال له الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم: كفى، وما وجد هذا الصحابي إلا ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عيناه تذرفان من الدمع. أقول: ثم بعد ذلك كان الصحابة رضوان الله عليهم أجمعين يسمعون القرآن من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، ومن الحفظة الذين كانوا من صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اشتهروا بذلك، وكانوا يتعلمون منهم القرآن، وكان يسمعون بعضهم بعضا ليحصل التعليم الذي بموجبه يتمكن المسلم من حفظ هذا الكتاب. هذا ما أعرفه مختصرا، والله تعالى أعلم.
والسؤال الثاني يا شيخ ما هي يعني الأولويات عند دراسة القرآن بين تجميل الصوت والتعلم وفقا لأحكام التجويد؟
كلا الأمرين اللذين ذكرتهما مهم لطالب القرآن الكريم وراغب حفظ القرآن الكريم. فجمال الصوت أمر مهم لأن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم كان جميل الصوت وكان يرتل القرآن ترتيلا، وصحابته الكرام كبار الحفظة الذين هم من الصحابة الكرام كانوا يهتمون بهذا الأمر، يهتمون بالأمرين الذين سألت عنهما، الاهتمام بالحفظ والاهتمام في نفس الوقت بحسن الصوت والترنم بالقراءة لعموم قول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: من لم يتغن بالقرآن فليس منا، ولقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم: زينوا أصواتكم بالقرآن. وكان صلى الله عليه وسلم يرغب أن يسمع القرآن من صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولما يحرج الصحابي من هذا الأمر كان يقول: إني أحب أن أسمعه من غيري، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. الأمران مهمان: الرغبة في التغني بالقرآن الكريم، والالتزام بأحكام التجويد، والاقتداء برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كما كان يقرأ عليه الصلاة والسلام. وهذا ما ظهر لي والعلم عند الله سبحانه وتعالى. أتمنى من كل من يرغب حفظ القرآن أن يرتل القرآن ترتيلا عملا بقول الله سبحانه وتعالى: ورتل القرآن ترتيلا، وعملا بفعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في تجويده وترتيله للقرآن الكريم. وكما أوصي حفظة القرآن الكريم أن يلتزم الجد والاجتهاد في حفظ هذا القرآن وفي ترتيله وتجويده وحسن صوته، وأن يقتدي بمن أرسل إليه الرسالة المحمدية ونزل عليه القرآن، ويهتم بالقراء الذين اشتهروا في عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، فهم القدوة لنا وهم الذين ينبغي أن نكون على هديهم وسنتهم. هذا مختصر ما عندي. أسأل الله الكريم رب العرش العظيم أن يوفق هذه الجمعية المباركة، وأن يكرم أبناءها لحفظ هذا الكتاب على حسب ما كان يقرأه صلى الله عليه وسلم، وكان يقرأه القراء الذين اشتهروا بقراءتهم وتجويدهم وترتيلهم في عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، كابن مسعود رضي الله عنه وغيرهم من صحابة رسول الله. أسأل الله للجميع التوفيق، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
It was subhanAllah. It was the Sheikh's passing. It was a difficult thing. SubhanAllah. I was asleep, and the alarm went off for Fajr, and I literally turned the alarm off, and the message was there that a Sheikh had passed away, and that was the beginning of my morning. It was a really sad start to the morning, SubhanAllah. And you know, I messaged his children, and each one of them replied back saying, yes, it's true, the Sheikh has passed away. And the ending of his story, SubhanAllah, his final days is amazing. The Sheikh, he's only done one interview in his life, and it's on YouTube. It was on some Kuwaiti channel when he was out there leading Salah. And towards the end, the presenter asked him, ما هي أمنيات الشيخ محمد أيوب? What are the wishes of Sheikh Muhammad Ayyoub?
يعني أمنية الوحيدة أن يكرمني الله عز وجل
نعم شيخنا،
بالعودة إلى الحرم النبوي الشريف لإمامة المصلين مرة أخرى قبل أن ألقى الله عز وجل.
Everyone knows that last Ramadan he was appointed back to lead Taraweeh in Masjid Nabawi, and Allah fulfilled his wish, and that was the final Ramadan of his life before he passed away just last Saturday. So Allah fulfilled his first wish, and his second wish was to see all of his children become successful and become Hufad of the Quran. And subhanAllah, his neighbor narrates that the Shaykh, he finished his circle in the Haram, then he sped off to his local masjid where he led Isha, and then after that he attended the party, a little gathering for his youngest 12-year-old daughter, his youngest one, the final child, who had just finished memorizing the Quran the night before, subhanAllah, the celebration the night before he passed away. After that he went home, went to sleep, and he woke up at Qiyam time, as he does to pray Qiyam al-Layl, and his daughter was with him, and he's told his daughter to turn the air conditioning on because it's very hot. He was feeling very hot towards the end. After he prayed Qiyam, he went to lie down for a little bit, fell asleep again, and his daughter came to wake him up, and he wouldn't wake up. So the Shaykh, rahimahullah, passed away in his sleep there. That was just before Fajr. And so I was watching a program just today where one of the presenters was saying it was amazing that the Shaykh passed away at around, the news got out around 7 a.m. and by Dhuhr time, they said the crowd of people in Al-Baqi, in the graveyard, in the courtyard, and in the Haram, was like Masjid Namira on Hajj. They said that, and this was on normal Dhuhr on a Saturday, which wouldn't be as packed. So literally the courtyards, the Haram, they said even some of the children of the Sheikh couldn't even get into the graveyard because they closed the graveyard off because of the amount of people in there. And I think the ulama and shuyukh and qurra from all over the world have been pouring in with their praises. And he was one of those people that no one had anything bad to say about. He was a man that just, he didn't involve himself in much of the dunya. He was known for his epic masterclass recitation. You know, people remember those 7 years in Masjid al-Nabawi as being some of the very best. Senior scholars have come and said that he is the best imam who has ever stood in the mihrab of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in current recent times. And anyone who listens to some of his qira'ah will see the emotional content. And I hope if I can just play maybe about 1 minute of one of the Sheikh's one of my favorite clips. This was from Masjid Nabawi in the year 1411 from Surah An-Nisa.
وَمَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ مِنْكُمْ طَوْلًا أَنْ يَنْكِحَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ فَمِمَّا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ مِنْ فَتَيَاتِكُمُ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِإِيمَانِكُمْ بَعْضُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْضٍ فانكحوهن بإذن أهلهن وآتوهن أجورهن بالمعروف محصنات غير مسافحات ولا متخذات أخدان فإذا أحصن فإن أتين بفاحشة فعليهن نصف ما على المحصنات من العذاب ذلك لمن خشي العنة منكم وأن تصبروا خير لكم والله غفور رحيم يريد الله ليبين لكم ويهديكم سنن الذين من قبلكم ويتوب عليكم والله عليم حكيم والله يريد أن يتوب عليكم ويريد الذين يتبعون الشهوات أن تميلوا ميلا عظيما يريد الله أن يخفف عنكم وخلق الإنسان ضعيفا.
So, subhanAllah, you can see why everyone loved him. Rahimahullah ta'ala. So we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts him from the people of Jannah, forgives him his sins, enters him into Jannah without hisab, and makes his time easy for his family and for all those who love him. And inshallah, we pray that we follow the example of the Shaykh in how we love the Quran, we hold on to it, we study it, we recite it, and we impress this upon our children as he did with his children as well. Rahimahullah ta'ala.
How old was he?
He was 65 years old. So he was, he was quite ill. He was ill for a while. But even despite his illness, every single day he would come to his classes on his own, drive there, go back to his masjid, lead Isha and Fajr. And he only stopped teaching in the Jamia up until 2014. So, and the Sheikh has a degree in Sharia from Faculty of Sharia, Madinah University. Then he did his master's and his PhD in Madinah University as well. in Quran, in tafsir. So the Sheikh was known to be very strong in tafsir as well as being a qari of the Quran.